The next topic we go to plastic surgery in trauma by Dr. Savari Girish Ambai. Dr. Savari Girish Ambai is MCH plastic surgery, junior consultant, surgical experience, October 2008, senior registrar in plastic surgery, senior resident in plastic surgery, teaching experience as an academic coordinator and tutor training DNP plastic postgraduates from October 2007. For wasting much of his time, may I request Dr. Savari Girish to give his talk.
Respected dignitaries, senior colleagues, and my dear friends. There's been a brainstorming session so far. I don't know how much I can justify what you have heard so far. But of course, I work in a department where we are four of us, Dr. Vino Desaris, and phone. with a flash. If you carefully see, the nose is deviated. That white line, white shadow which falls, can straight away tell you that this is some fracture which needs correction. And that is what how you confirm after doing the surgery also. So these are small fine tricks which you can do. When the situation is worse, along with the nose, the frontal bone is also fractured and the patient has got caesar rhinorrhea. Our neurosurgery colleagues request us to come for a treatment for the CSF rhinorrhea, where you have to block the anterior cranial fossa. There, along with it, we do the job of the aesthetic part, where the neurosurgeon will cut open and give us all the bones in bits and pieces, and we sit in a side table and try to fix everything up like a jigsaw puzzle and put it back to get a good result. Cheekbone is also a common bone which usually gets fractured, zygoma. It needs a proper reduction and a fixation with a plate or screws to get a good aesthetic outcome. There are then tricky areas. We won't talk about the normal fractures in the mandible because it's done by everybody. But then there are areas, for example, you see the condyle is broken and bent inwards. There is no way by which this can reduce and come back to its position. All what you can do is to bring it back, fix it with something. A simple intermaxillary fixation or stuff like that doesn't work. Why people are not keen on doing this? Because there is a facial nerve which comes across and it is very tricky to manipulate at that level. So with good knowledge and with a good neural nerve stimulator and good idea, if you go in, you can fix it, get a good result. And then you have these gory fractures and injuries which happen in industries, like a blast injury, what happened to him in an industry. And you have an open wound, bad looking wound, and when you take a 3D CT, the whole front midface is smashed along with the mandible. When these cases come to you, it is not about only the bones, it is not about only these tissues, it is more about, you know, getting everything in the right place, including the muscles, the nerves, the loss of skin, everything has to be looked into. That is where our role comes in. So, for the bony part, it ended up having 9 plates in right alignment, and this is how he looks. So, in order to get this, the primary treatment where the patient is taken in for surgery, the person who is going to do it should be well equipped with everything, not only the metal plates and screws, they should be mentally prepared to even do many other things to heal the wound. Primary healing is the word which you should remember. Case of assault, a small child, completely avulsed mandible is lying here with a fracture, the tongue is here, the whole of the lower face is completely avulsed. We were initially worried about the vascularity, but children are great healers. You put back things in the right place, usually they heal well. And this is around 4 years down the line. You can even see the tooth has erupted and the bone has survived. So these kind of cases usually need a lot of reconstructive work and effort in the primary instance. Now I look into a lower limb trauma, for which usually the plastic surgeons are called, because there is always edema and there is always loss of skin. One of the best way of examining a patient is not to give him pain. I am not a person who is very keen on giving him a lot of wash with saline in the emergency, and the patient is screaming in the top of his voice. There is no point. You have to look into the vascularity. You have to look whether the foot leg is tense to check out whether there is a compartment syndrome or something like that, and see what is the problem. And then probably once it is everything is done, you shift him to theater and do it painless. What might look like a simple laceration which can be sutured back is actually an avulsion of the skin. And mostly, majority of this part of the skin will die if you leave it alone or if you suture it back. This is where you should be able to assess the skin loss, which is not evident. And that is what we do when you do the theater and you debride till where the healthy bleeding starts and then put a skin graft to heal these wounds. So, lower leg is always a challenge. a case of insolence of bones where the lateral malleolus is exposed, the peroneal tendons are exposed, already old enough for probably 2 weeks, the skin has become gangrenous. But with the advancement in knowledge about how the skin survives, how the skin vascularity is, you can move in large sections of skin around and heal these wounds. What we call as propeller flaps, something like a blade of a propeller, you can twist around the skin based on a single blood vessel which is arising from the peroneal vessels to heal the wound. This is a post-operative. And then you once in a while get these kind of injuries where you are not sure whether you should amputate or you should save it. Two criteria which we usually look into is whether the foot is vascular, whether the foot is sensate. If the foot is sensate, and even if the foot is not vascular, you should try to save it. So this is how the X-ray showed, and it is here that where the teamwork really matters, in the golden hour, where the orthopedician tries to fix whatever is available, and then we debride, and evidently we have a defect with an exposed implant down there at a raw area, which in 48 hours we covered it with a freeze anterolateral thigh flap based on the blood vessels to heal these wounds. But unfortunately the same fellow went into a non-union at the upper end of the tibia because the bone stock was not really good. So again we went in with the same pedicle and put in a fibula we took from the other side leg along with the blood vessels. These are all not non-vascular grafts, these are vascular fibular grafts. It survives just like another bone. And then finally got a healing, and this is how he is at present. So he walks with it. So it is very important that there are people around you who can help you. And as a team, if you work, you can save many more limbs. And the worst thing what can happen is a complete amputation or a dismembering of a part of the body. 1-year-old child was sitting in a cycle in the front and his leg got stuck and it just snapped away. The patient comes to you with a 5-toe amputated. Here we are in a dilemma, a 1-year-old child, whether the child should be put into a 4-hour surgery. But then there are, you take that risk just because that the child usually if you put, the results are good. So you take the risk and go ahead. And with the sound anatomy that if I can put one artery, all the toes should survive based on the blood vessels and the blood spaces. So one artery, one vein, and don't do anything else. Just send, hope for the best. So that's how you go. Can you click in the center? Oops. Gone back. Click. No. Back. Click. No, one more. Go back. Yeah. Just to give you a glimpse, this is under the microscope. So you don't fix all fractures. You try to put two wires and the rest of things get aligned. All these clips are, of course, Shekhar sir would be knowing, Liger clips. These are all less than 1 millimeter vessels. You find one vessel in the bed space and put it. And you use what we use, around 10-0 and 11-0 sutures, nylon sutures. This is all magnified almost up to 20 times. So. And then we put a vein. And unfortunately, we lost the big toe because if you have carefully seen, the web space was not really good in the between the first hand and the first toe. But of course, we saved 4 toes. You click? Yeah. So as we thought, you know, the blood flows through the toes if the web space is alright. So it is seen in the second, third toe and all. And you just align the nerves, there is no much time, because it's already 4 to 5 hours. So, but still they heal well, they grow well, so the sensation also was good. And the child walks. But we, in Apollo First Med, we usually specialize in upper limb trauma. Of course, we do all this, but we do it a little more, with a lot more of passion probably. We do hand injuries. So when we sit in the emergency, we find all sorts of injuries, industrial, road traffic, and never mind, you should also remember, some happen in the kitchen. So I feel that hand itself is an organ, and these kind of movements, I don't think we have any robot which can match it. And when a hand is affected of an individual, usually he is off job, so the family suffers, and because the production is not there, usually the nation also suffers. It's a huge impact, and 40 to 45% of all injuries to the human bodies happen to hand. That's where my mentor and my professor, Arun Venkateswamy, comes into the picture. He's a Stanley. He is the first person who started the hand surgery service in Chennai and all around India. And he has a saying, creative hands should be protected at all costs, and that is what we strive for. He was awarded the pioneer of hand surgery. Next. We have a dedicated hand service unit around the clock, 24 hours. And we take the history and all those things, and we do a very painless examination. What we need to know is whether the finger is alive or not, whether it's sensate or not, is there any deformity. That's all. Rest everything should be managed in the theater. The simplest way to do it is not a pinprick. Nowadays we have a pulse ox. Put a pulse ox. See whether it's showing saturation, waveforms. It will easily tell you whether the finger is alive or not. But in hand, compared to all other areas, the primary aim is to heal it in the first go. You should not delay healing, because if you delay, then there are other problems which start coming, like stiffness, etc. And always remember, in hand injuries, usually the mobility is the watchword. Keep moving. And of course, this is Professor's lab, which he had planned for, he designed and he executed, and it is published also for a fingertip injury. Of course, along with it, we have fractures, common fractures. And then some complicated, tricky fractures like the head of the metacarpal, Doxer's fractures, which we call. These fractures restrict finally the range of movement will be affected. So unless you fix it well with the, we use a SS wire, and if you can fix it well, usually the range function is good. Then there are fractures which need plate and screws, and some of them surprisingly need a small external fixator like this, a distraction device. Example, base of the middle phalanx fracture, comminuted, where it usually happens in a cricket ball injury, direct injury to the tip. So if you can get them early and do a proper job, usually the results are good. It looks like a simple small chip fracture in the base of the terminal phalanx usually has a tendon attached to it, the extensor tendon. Patient comes to you with a mallet. It's very important that you fix the fracture and fix the then extends out to the flexor tendons, which usually you have to identify and pull. And this is a case where the industrial accident, apart from the crush injury, there was a thermal component also, which we had to first heal it with put a free flap. But unfortunately, the skin over the fingers necrosed later, and then we had to put another groin flap to heal it. Why we do all this in an aggressive way is basically you delay it, the results are poor. So you have to get all the possibilities to get it healed fast. And some injuries do happen in the kitchen. For example, in this child who was playing, and usually it was complete, all tendons, nerves, everything was cut. But if they come on time, usually you can put it back. And the rarest of all is usually an amputation. All varieties you see, for example, a ring avulsion, which is very common when people get down from PTC bus, their finger with the ring gets stuck in a hook or a nail, and then they get down, the bus moves, so the skin gets avulsed. But if you can bring them back, usually you can put it back. And that was a partial, and this is a complete. Usually, even after 10 hours, This patient was for 10 hours, so you can put it back. That is the best part. And if you put it back, the results are complete. No amputation is small for a reimplant. Even the smallest of a small can be put back if it looks decently good. Then there are glory ones where everything is a problem, but still, if even among the two, if one you can put it back. For this case, the middle finger was put into the ring finger, and we used the skin of the ring finger to cover the areas, the raw areas. So this is after 3 months. So every finger has a value. And in first month, we do maximum number of radial pressure injury cases in the country. We have a group also, especially dedicated to brachial plexus injury patients. It usually affects the young and the productive age. Can you keep that? Yeah. Except upper plexus palsy, C5 and C6 alone, where the child is not able to lift the arm and bend the elbow, but he is able to straighten the elbow. Can you click this? So mainly the two nerves occurred, but the remaining three are okay. These cases, we can assure them nowadays almost a very good result. It can be almost normal. The problem comes only when the injury involves all the roots, what we call as a total palsy or a pan-brachial plexus palsy. For example, this guy. But it should be very important that you see them early, catch them early, and do the surgery very early, because time is very, very important in these cases. If you carefully see the MRI shows pseudomeningocele all along, and there is no movement after 3 months. So we do what we call as a all-in-one, where we try to coapt plenty of nerves. Every nerve around which possible is coapted, up to 9 to 10 nerves we put. And this is what we can offer. This is after 3 years he was able to achieve. This is one of the best results, and he continues to work in a petrol pump. He carries big drums and all of oil. So these patients are somebody who don't have anything. For someone who don't have anything, a little is a lot, and that is where we should put our heart and soul. Thank you.